general manager of the entire facility. I'll tell a short 30-second story. He was our greenskeeper, superintendent, whatever that title is, and did a fantastic job on the golf course. And they asked him to be the general manager, and I called the owners and said, no, don't do that, you know? He's got to stay on the course. And they said, no, we talked to him, and he said he could do it, and let me tell you, he has done it. Everything that needed to be fixed, weeds, landscaping, he knows about it. And by the way, he's gonna announce, I'll tell him tonight, the pool will soon be open for day club, starting within the next 30 days or so. So you'll be able to enjoy that in the summertime. Also, is Teresa or Karen? I don't see them. Okay. They are the current managers of the HOA. Petra Fahey, she is the broker currently on the project called The Canyons. Ann Pettit is here, and when nothing was really moving in the 2015-2016-ish, she came here and made it happen. And if you see these beautiful homes along the fairway, her and her group do quite a few of those. And so, Annette, Ann, thank you. Now this goes back, here we go. Sandy Port, first broker for Nationwide Homes. There she is right there. I didn't see Dana. Dana was bent on coming. I hope nothing happened to him. Dana was first agent with Sandy. Next is Ken Sharp. Ken?
Where's Ken?
Where's Ken? Kenny's in the back. Ken Sharp was in, we kind of inherited him into Laughlin Ranch. He was actually a personal employee for my wife Michelle and I in Scottsdale. And if there's anything that had to get done, he knew how to get it done. And if any of you, Jack, I know you were there, in 2004 was the 20th anniversary of Bullhead City being incorporated. And so Laughlin Ranch agreed to put on the fireworks show. And if you remember, it was like 18 minutes synced to a radio station. And that was all Ken Sharp. He did all that. Ulysses, are you here, Ulysses? Yes. Oh, Ulysses in the back. Ulysses is kind of now in charge of the golf course, but the story with Ulysses is that my girlfriend at the time, Janet, he was related to Ulysses and he was looking for a job. I said, guess what? There's a golf course about to go down and we need to roll out a whole bunch of sod and everything else. And so he came on with us and he's been there the whole time, 20 years. Also, I didn't see Nick or Emilio. Nick was the manager of the River Queen, who understand that. Okay. So Nick and his wife, they were, I was almost family with them, legally. I was almost legally family with them, but we're still family anyway. But Nick and his uncle Emilio, who was the maintenance manager of the River Queen. And all of that will come back in the story here in a minute. Also, Dale Milligan, is Dale? Dale Milligan. Dale Milligan was the guy I found, I says, do you know how to do accounting? And he says, yeah, I need to do accounting. I says, well, I need an accountant. And so he was hired on the spot, and he became the first accountant for Laughlin Ranch.
That was not an easy job.
Yes. Oh, by the way, I have a note up here. I should have read it first. If I forget anybody, please throw something at me or whatever. Just let me know. But I have overlooked one. Norma Brummett, Bullhead City Council member. Let's see, and last but certainly not least is Jeff Arganda. He's in charge of video tonight and also the photos that have been taken around. He's quite, I don't know if you saw the drone pictures, the pictures that were running here a few minutes ago. That was all Jeff that did that. And then, the one guy that honestly I can say knows everything about Bullhead City is Bill McMillan. And he, Bill's here tonight representing Ahoggie Daily News, but he was here when I got here in 202, so I know he's been here a while, but always does a fantastic job. So that is our invited guest group, and now the team that put all this together. I'm going to say this part here of... He wasn't officially, but he was always there for us. And he's passed away long ago. I will forever miss Tom Griffin, the most... I can ask Tom Griffin, you know, that corner down there, how many people have owned that? And he would come back and pull out his file out of his office and say, well, it was owned by this company and this company. He knew everything about the county. He also was involved in the moving of London Bridge to Lake Havasu. Played a significant part in that. To Tom, I didn't want to talk tonight without mentioning him. Okay, first, Don Anderson, our head engineer. Don? I can tell you with certainty that every inch of Laughlin Ranch is on one of his plats or lot splits or whatever. And Don continues to be very active up here. He's been handling the section sales we've been doing the last couple of years, the different subdivisions that wanted to come on. Don is the guy that does it. By the way, he also... when the city needs extra help in engineering, they call Don Anderson. So yeah, it gives you an idea how good that guy really is at what he does. He also helped me on the parkway getting built from Laughlin Ranch Boulevard down to 95. He also helped get the Dot Foods deal engineered. There's a billboard down at the bridge. He helped us getting that done. I know he represents Fox Creek and many, many, many others. So that's Don Anderson. This the next couple, Lyle Jones and Cindy Jones. Laughlin Ranch is not Laughlin Ranch without Lyle and Cindy. Lyle was, I could never beat him into the office. I try sometimes to go in a little early. He was already there. He was always the last one. He was there when I left. So he was our on-site engineer. So he was coordinating with Don, but all the changes, any amendments, everything like that, that's what Lyle did every single day. Cindy Jones was our office manager. And on Fridays, Cindy and I had a code, okay? And the code was this: cold, warm, hot, on fire. And that's how we put the stacks of the invoices that were due. So she gave me a three-day weekend to find the money. But she was always there, and she was a great support to the whole operation. The next group will be, you'll recognize from the projects that they have built and designed here. The first will be Dave Drzyski from Drzyski Golf. Doug had just completed a golf course And I knew Doug a little bit through his, my wife and his wife had connections, but I knew he was a golf course designer. So I said, well, somebody I know, go talk to him. But he took me up, we went up to Las Vegas, and he did two courses that this area of town will recognize. Bighorn in Palm Springs, and Dragon Ridge in Las Vegas, Henderson. And so those are his courses. He's gone on to build many, many, many courses around, mostly in the West. Are you still based in Boise?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, good. Also now he's added Brazil to his repertoire for golf. So if when you play the golf course, and you love it or hate it, depending on how you play it, Doug's responsive. I'll have his mobile number for you available after. The next one, of course, is Doug Fredrickson. Doug, just a hand up. Where do we start with Doug? When I was talking to Doug originally about what I wanted to build here, I said I wanted to be true to the history of this area. 1900s construction type of things, and I wanted to reflect the steamboat history and the mining history. So I think that's about the last instruction that I ever gave to Doug, because he just took that guidance, and you're sitting in it. You did it. And he has projects all over Arizona, high-end homes, but his forte is golf course renovation and golf course construction. So that's what he does. And his partner's here. Want to just wait? Yeah. Okay, the next one is Swaback Partners. And I don't know if we have anybody here from Swaback tonight.
No, they send their regrets.
Okay, well, I'm still going to talk about it. So they're defenseless. Swaback Partners is renowned worldwide. Vern Swaback was a protege to Frank Lloyd Wright and worked on the Talisman West in Scottsdale. That was Vern's project. So he is called upon to do some of the big master plan projects, land planning, all the little things that go into that in terms of what type of landscaping. As a matter of fact, if anybody here is living in Laughlin Ranch and you follow the CCNRs and the design guidelines for Laughlin Ranch, were written by Swaback Partners. So if you want to know why we have this tree here or so many bushes here, it's because that is the look that we started with and finishing. And we're very strict about it. So anyway, Swaback Partners, unbelievable. Roll Construction, did we get?
There is not a representative from Roll here, unfortunately. Okay. Some of their subcontractors.
Well, who's the subcontractors for Roll?
Well, funny you should ask. T. Goddamn Morris, right?
Yeah. All right, okay. Name next to you?
Brian?
No. The guy who built the.
Tony.
I'm sorry? Tony? Yeah. I'm sorry. I'm just spacing. Okay. Tony is responsible for all the plumbing and all the facilities that we have. So, if you use a sink in the bathroom or any other thing that has water in it, that is Tony. The next one is Landscapes Unlimited. And I don't know if do we have a landscape?
Landscape?
Okay, there they are on the back. Okay, perfect. I saw you come in. I didn't know you were doing. So we got Landscapes, we have Clay Featherbay and Chad. Kind of just raise your hand so we know where you guys are at.
Chad didn't make it.
Oh, he didn't make it? Okay. Clay? Hand up? Okay, there's Clay. He built the know how this thing has to kind of function is that you have somebody design the golf course, and then you have to have somebody engineer the golf course in terms of moving the dirt. Okay, do we have the dirt go here so that the course is undulating this way and all that? That is what Landscapes does. By the way, they have literally over 1,500. They told me earlier, I thought it was 1,500 projects. Now they're 2,000 projects. So Landscapes Unlimited, Swaback Partners, all these groups are the best available. And since I never knew anything about development, I said, well, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to surround myself with the people that do know it and then try to stay out of their way. Tim Flanagan, Tim, somewhere around here, I saw him. There he is, Tim. With us on the special marketing programs. We've got Tom Morris over there. Last but not least, certainly not least, but I saved it for the end, and that is, Morgan Neville. I was trying to raise money every day, and Morgan was the connection to me that kept me up to speed that they're doing this, or they're doing this, or Landscape's doing this, and so I had one person to talk to, and it was handy because I could cry at night, you know, and I was there, but he literally was my right hand up here. He was CEO of Laughlin Ranch LLC. He actually took over probably a lot more responsibilities than just that, but he really was my glue that held it all together.
Still just a classy guy. I mean, we'll never meet another person like Dave Lords, and he doesn't want me to probably stand up here and talk about him. Did not prepare anything. I don't have notes, Dave.
You're all right.
Okay. But what I think Dave would want us to focus on this occasion is something that got accomplished and built, you know, that took a lot of people to be brought together, and it's about Laughlin Ranch. And this is the anniversary of that. And all the characters you named from the very start, Dale and the original ride around. There's so many stories and so many wonderful interludes with people. So I did think today about what would I want to reflect on. I haven't been back here since the day I left, so this is special for me. Well, I did. Thank you. I did not consciously avoid this valley. I know. Those valley people, you know, there's. But I've been back in the valley, been busy raising a family, and everyone's happy and healthy. And but what I think struck me the most driving up Laughlin Ranch Boulevard was the endurance of what was built. The level of design, the freedom you gave, the very talented team that you talked about assembling, you always sought out the best. Doug Terpstra, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He designed the landscape for the community. We can't go without talking about Doug. And so how this all was able to happen, I think a couple important things to point out.
Obviously,
it took a vision that really none of us in this room is probably capable of. You know, we have dreams and stuff. You know, you're literally asleep and dreaming. But Dave came here, looked up the hill, saw something, saw potential, saw the beautiful vistas. And so it started with the nature, it started with the availability of the land, but it took a vision. And to make that vision a reality, which is the reality of this built structure that we're in that will stay built for another, you know, 100 years probably, is a real testament to, it's just an amazing vision, Dave. And everyone who's touched this project has articulated that at some point. How did this guy do this? And then how did he have the huevos to make it happen? The amount of energy that Dave expended in a short amount of time probably took years off your life. It took a few years off mine. But it was amazing. So the vision, I wanted to just point out that obvious thing. The other thing that I would tell you about Dave that's important is that it was about the people. It was always about the people. It was the people he saw in this city. And he felt a real connection. Somehow you felt kindred spirits with the people who scraped out a living here on the Colorado River. And it really touched him. And he wanted to make everyone happy and successful around him in this community. So that's an amazing thing. And he tried so hard and he accomplished so much. But it was always about the people and giving people opportunities, giving creative people opportunity to show us the best of what they can do, whether it's in a building like this or a golf course or landscape or engineering. My God, the most undulating, difficult, civil land you could be working with between Lyle and Don, figuring all that out. How to make all these plans actually fit topography like this is insane. So, I'm rambling a little bit here. It was about the people. He wanted people to be successful. He wanted people to be creative. He wanted all boats to rise on the same tide. Jack, remember that? That was Dave's vision. If we do good up here, everyone does good. And Jack bought into that and smoothed the path for Dave's vision.
Thanks, Jack.
So it was the vision and the people. And then quality. In life, you can do things half-ass. You can do things on the cheap. Sometimes you have to do these things, right? You have to. We're forced with economics. But Dave never skimped on the quality. And that affected so many thousands of decisions. And it was amazing that he was always willing to give whatever it took to make that quality happen. And so when there was a decision to be made about, you know, do we do this or do we do that? He always erred on the side of permeability and beauty and durability. And so that's amazing. And that's why this place endures and will continue to endure. And we all so hope that the next subdivision or two or three just keep going because of what you started here. It will all be good. From a personal standpoint, I've told Dave what he's meant to me in my life, and for years he was as if a brother, an older brother. So, and I don't throw that around lightly, and Dave knows that because he was absolutely a part of the Neville family for some wonderful years. And so I thank you, Dave, for everything you gave to me, every opportunity. I need to say this publicly because then my career and the mentors you helped introduce me to changed my life. Lyle Jones, Don Anderson, Adele Collins, these people changed my life, helped form who I've been. So I've tried to go on and spread some of what you spread on all of us. And maybe we can all just keep doing that and make the world a little bit better place, tell a little bit better story, and we could all get there eventually. So we love you, Dave, and thank you so much for having us all here.
Morgan.
notes that I had to have to make sure we had Jack. Come on up, Jack.
I can recall when David first came into my office and he laid out this plan on the table. And I thought, what the hell is that? And he started to tell me what he wanted to build in Laughlin Ranch. And he wanted to call it Laughlin Ranch. And I thought, it's a great name. We don't have any cows up here. But he went on and on. And I could recall the things that he did for this city that has been absolutely incredible. He's a giver. He's a giver to the city. He's helped us out. Whenever I needed him for something, he was there. Whenever I said, Dave, I need a little help, he was there. And for that, I say, God bless you. You've kept your word. You made this city a hell of a lot better than what it was. And you helped build it. Thank you so much, David.
Thank all of you for your hard work. Yes. Woo!
want to belabor it. I have to tell you that about 5 nights ago, I had dinner with my mom and dad, and I told her about this event, and she goes, I said, it's at the beginning of Laughlin Ranch. And she goes, I'm the beginning of Laughlin Ranch. So, for my mom, what I did was, that's my parents. In 1955, 9 months and 1 day later, I was born. I asked my mom, what was I upset about? Apparently, back in those days, they would take the kids to get a portrait taken of them. And I didn't like that idea. There's my mother. In 2015, on her 60th anniversary between my mom and dad, and that's her wedding dress. That's just in that photo. And that's me and my trike in my backyard in San Francisco. Okay, so that's the beginning. Here's the beginning of Laughlin Ranch. Just so you know, it happened totally by accident. It was not planned. It wasn't my something I was planning to do, but John Weaver, who's a land auctioneer in Phoenix, he called me because I bought some other pieces for other clients. He said, "Dave, I got these two sections of ground, and you can get them for probably maybe $500 an acre." And I said, "Well, what about that?" And he showed me. I came prepared for this. Where was that?
This is the first piece,
and this is the second piece, right there. And that was what we bought, sight unseen. The auction was down at your community center, the Chamber of Commerce building. That's where they held the auction. I bid over the phone. I kept bumping some guy in the room. He didn't believe there was anybody on the phone, so he picked up the phone and said, "Who are you?" And I said, "Who are you?" And so anyway, the bidding ended at $453 an acre on terms with 20% down. And the only reason I thought it might be worthwhile, because when John Weaver told me, I said, "Where is it?" He says, "Bullhead City." And I said, "Literally, where is Bullhead City?" And so I looked it up, and I saw this subdivision right there. And at that time, in 2002, you could buy a lot for $25,000. And so we're in the lots at $450 an acre. And I said, this is probably a pretty good deal. Now, the person I'm talking to, by the way, on this project is Bill Lund. Bill Lund is within the Disney family, which I will show. So on this day, this is the Dale Coleman story. I came up here only to do a property inspection, go back to Bill Lund and tell him that, you know, we're okay. And Dale Collins, on a tour of Bullhead City, because I'd never seen it before. And we were driving around, and Dale took us to about where the entryway is right now of Laughlin Ranch. And I said, "Man, this is beautiful. Look at those." I lived on the mountain in McDowell Mountain Ranch in Scottsdale. And so I was envisioning this McDowell Mountain Ranch on this property. So I asked Dale, I said, "Dale, you know, we own the one piece and the south piece." I said, "You know, what is the story on that? Who owns the property in the middle?" And Dale says, "Well, a guy named Don Laughlin." I said, "Don Laughlin, who's he?" And I didn't know. I had never been here before. I didn't know Don Laughlin. And so he said, "Yeah, Don Laughlin." And he says, "You know, we'll try to get an appointment." Well, he was driving me back to my car, and of all things, Tom Griffin was in the office on a Saturday. And so I went in there and talked to Tom, told him what I wanted. He said he would try to get an appointment for us, and he did on Monday. So I go back up. So this is what I saw. that day. Okay, that's Laughlin Ranch. All right, so that's what you're out that window. That's what you're seeing. I saw this, and I said,
these mountains
are way better in Wisconsin. This could be something. So I said, how do you know? We got Don. So we went over and met Don on Monday. Don said, well, which section do you want? I said, oh. And he says, how much are you going to pay? Well, I paid $450 for these. How about $1,200? And so that was his price. And so because he was the centerpieces, I had to have it. So I bought those five from Don. But the other thing is if you look all that other green that's there without dots on them, that's 10 more sections. That's 6,400 acres. And they were owned by people all over this country. And when I would track them down and call them at their house, it was like Moses had come out of the desert. Because their families had owned this, not their families, their grandparents. They didn't even know where it was. And so so I told them, well, I think I can probably get you maybe $500. And so I got a couple at five, a couple at $750. Don was the most expensive, of course, at $1,200. But the point is that I didn't want any other section of ground to be inside my plan. I didn't want to go to all this planning and expense and then have a junkyard or something, right in the middle. So it was imperative that I get the rest of these. Now, I couldn't do this myself. I didn't have the resources to pay for all of this. And the idea was, is take that, create this, and I had to go to the investors and say, this is what I want to do. And you can imagine that they were a little bit shocked because it was the first time I'd ever been in Bullhead City. I come back, I had sold real estate to them in Maricopa, Casa Grande, Eloy, just all that whole south area. And I'm talking about Mojave County and Bullhead City. So they made the deal. They said, we'll do it, but you have to be there. This has to be your project. We're not going to have you rely on anybody else. It's you on the hot seat. So the man in the middle, it's Bill Lump, and he is the son of Walt Disney. That is Bill and Sharon Disney on the left with the three kids, and that's Sharon next to her dad, Walt Disney. So that is the connection to Disney. People think I was dealing with Disney Company, Disney family. And each of those family members have a tiny little trust that they can use every once in a while, like about $500 million. But I don't know if this is still true, but I was told that Victoria Lund, Bill's daughter, with out of her trust, she made 50 a year. That was the... So there's Bill a little bit later. Now, I asked Bill to do one favor for me, and I wanted to get married to my then fiance Yvette, and I said, but I want to get married in Disneyland. And he said, I said, can you help me out? So Bill arranged for Mick to be my best man, and Minnie to be Yvette's maid of honor. Now, this next story actually happened exactly how I'm going to tell you. Yvette was walking down the aisle. There's a landscape area to the right where tourists and hotel guests and so don't come into this area. This little girl looked underneath the bushes and ran to Yvette with her little book and said, Cinderella, Cinderella. So the wedding stopped, the music stopped, everything stopped.
And Yvette talked to her
a little bit for a couple minutes and then signed her a little book. And then her mortified parents came and collected her. So that was, it was such a moment that I never could forget that. It was just unbelievable. The second partner is the gentleman on the left. That's Bill Hines. He owned a couple of banks down in Phoenix and was a great friend of mine. And he was the second investor into Laughlin Ranch. Don, of course, is there. He helped by selling the land to do Laughlin Ranch. I told you I had to go down and meet Tom Griffin. That is Tom on the left, his wife Dee on the right. This is Cindy and Lyle. The reason we're all dressed up is we want... is we won for the Community Achievement Awards. We were awarded Large Business of the Year, I think is what they call it. Don sold me Graham, but he became a partner with me as well. And not only that, but just an unbelievable friend. Don, this one on the right, I just had to do it. It's so typical of Don. This is 1993, and he had a bucket list to walk across the Colorado River. And so it was down to a half unit, so he walked across it. He's got his life jacket on, he's ready for any emergency. As you know, Don started with very little, built an incredible resort. I kind of started with nothing, and we built, with all these people, this resort. Don loved being around the heavy equipment. Don was instrumental in several things that we did with the city. Fantastic. I have to show this picture. This is posted throughout the casino at the Riverside. But Don, I said, Don, let's go to Europe and meet these investors from Holland. And he said, well, I want to go see my hometown in Galway, Ireland. And I said, okay. And so he calls a couple people, and we land in London. We spend a couple days there. And then we go over to Ireland. Now I'm picturing a reception, maybe something like this size, maybe smaller. We made the turn on the corner. There was over 350 people there, like the Pope arrived. And so this picture, just to show you what Don attracts, the Prime Minister of Ireland and the President of the European Union, and they were our greeting party. Don and I try to meet at least once a week. It used to be every night back in the day. Just to chat, whatever, for an hour. And one night, he said he wanted ice cream, so we went down to the cafe. And I showed this, and he ate four waffle cone mint chocolate chip ice cream cones in less than 30 minutes. Okay, so now back to the project. And there's Dave, you met him earlier. That is a golf hole, or soon to be a golf hole. This is, anybody that has played golf here, this is hole number 13. It's up at the top, looking down. That is what the golf course looked like when we started. Again, we had lined up, getting everything going. We had a groundbreaking. I know Morgan's on the right, Tom Stockwell was a caddy supervisor. That mustache guy, I don't know, Bill Lund. Of course, Don, the two ladies owned Avalon Homes. There's Bill Hines, the second money in, and of course, Lyle on the side. Throwing some dirt up. Again, just pictures of everybody. These are some of my favorite pictures, the amount of time that Morgan and I spent, and you know, just every day, it's gonna happen, it's gonna happen. We did have, in our grand opening, donated a check, that's not the important part, for the Boys and Girls Club for $5,000, who is it that I'm handing it to?
Dave Heath,
20 years ago. Now here's another, my plane only holds four passengers and a crew. It's a call of bearer. And I had all these professionals, the people you're looking at, that you introduced, that I needed to have up from the valley, up the project, every day. So the answer was, I formed an airline. And that was my new plane. I split it with
Western Express.
It's right there on the back. We were licensed service to the point where I didn't like the plane sitting here after they drop off the guys at 8 in the morning, and then we have to wait till 4 o'clock till they come back to take it to Scottsdale. So I worked out a deal where I would fly passengers from the Riverside to Riverside, California, pick up passengers in Riverside, bring them back up. We would get those passengers off, our crew would get on, back to Scottsdale by dinner time.
Thank you.
That's my partner, Bill try to deck it out. We didn't pack it in. This is the most popular plane in the Caribbean for tours, and they packed like 14 people in it. Ours had 10 seats and a bathroom, which I thought was important. Now my next problem was, I've got hundreds of construction workers on their way to Bullhead City to start moving dirt and doing everything that they do. And so I tried out the idea of buying bulk rooms from Don. The rooms were nice. The problem was the guys were coming into work the next morning not feeling too good, and maybe their pockets were a little lighter when they got there. So I asked Don, I said, Don, can I buy your hotel? And he said, yeah, and so I did. So I bought the River Queen Hotel from Don. And Morgan, is that your unit? I can't. Yeah, it's either Dale Milligan's or it's yours, one of the two.
So, we kicked operations out because I realized what an asset it was.
So now, as they mentioned earlier, the iron has arrived. And this is just a portion of it. This is not the full fleet. These are some other rippers and all that. I sound like I know what I'm talking about. Starting to move the dirt, for instance, where we're sitting here was much higher. Everything had to be taken down. We had to create pads for lots. And so that's what these guys are starting at the top. Some other big equipment, you see the bulldozer pushing the earth mover because the dirt is so heavy. This equipment on the right, the grader, that's something that Pat Burright would use. And Pat, do you want to tell your first part of the story and then I'll pick it up from there, or do you want me to? Wherever you want.
About Steve?
Yes, of course.
Well, we have this inspector out here that I can only put like 20 feet of pipe in the ground and then he'd make you tear it out.
Because we can't hear him.
Okay. So we were getting these new inspectors every week from EPCOR, and I was kind of EPCOR water now, City of Bullhead City, thank God. So I was basically training them as we were going, but this one fellow, his name was Steve Rapez, I said, however you want us to do it, we'll do it just like you want. So he explains everything, we get 200 or 300 feet of pipe in the ground, I leave to go to another part of the job. I get this call from one of my superintendents, and he says, he's making us tear it all out. I'm like, why? So I come over there, and I start talking to the guy. I'm like, why are we tearing it out? And he's like, well, it's not right. And I'm like, you stood right here with us and told us exactly how you wanted to put it in. And he's like, well, you sure got a nice truck. And I'm not really picking up what he's putting down. I'm like, well, thanks for the truck, but we need to get some pipe in the ground. We need to get going. Nope, we need to take the pipe out. So what do? I take the pipe all out. We start all over. Put the pipe in. He's happy. I leave. Next day, superintendent calls me. He says, we're tearing his pipe back out. Now I'm getting a little irritated, So I go over. I get over there and I'm like, what is the deal? And he's like, well, you really got a nice truck. I said, you want me to take you down to Ford? I'm thinking to myself, all I'm going to do is, get this guy to be a friend or something. He says, sure. I said, okay. So I put him in my truck, and I'm thinking, now this is going to work, because I've been talking a while, and I'm like, I'm tearing out pipe, and I'm putting it in the ground, and he's wanting to know why we ain't going faster, and I'm like, as fast as I go, I tear it back out. I don't understand. So I take him down to Ford, and I get him a cost deal. The manager of Ford writes his personal name, personal cell phone, the price of the truck on the back of the card, and hands it to him. So he's like, okay, we get out of there. He's like, that's a pretty good deal, huh? I'm like, that's the best deal you're going to get. I mean, that's a cost. I mean, they give you a really good deal. He says, okay. So he keeps the card. Next morning, I get out there, and I'm thinking everything's going to be fine, but he's wanting us to tear the stuff back out. I'm like, well, what did we do wrong? I'm starting to
write a check for $50,000, you can have the truck as soon as you leave, you know? He's like, well, when do we get it? And I'm like, now I'm picking up what he's putting down. I'm like, you want me to buy a truck? And he's like, well, yeah. And I'm like, let me take you to the owner here. If he wants to give me $50,000 to buy you a truck, I'll do it. But it turned into a little bit more than that. I'll let Dave finish the story.
So, Mr. Steve Repetz is blackmailing our engineers and our company and saying, I want a truck. And I said, well, send him into my office. I want to talk to that guy. And so he comes in. I said, what's this thing about you want a pickup truck from Pat? He says, well, yeah, but he says, I got a solution for you. You will not have one more problem with any inspection if you give me $424,000. I said, okay, let me get this right. Okay, so I made him repeat it. So I said, you know what, give me a day or two, I'll get back to you. So I drove straight to the police department. I said, hey, this guy, you know, he wants $424,000 or he's going to hold permits or you know, reject this. And the chief head, I love the guy, and then they had the district attorney there, and they said, it's not enough. We got to have this guy on tape. And so I went to Walmart, and I got a little microphone and everything like that. And I invited
Steve. Aren't you a part-time sheriff in America?
I was that, but now I'm U.S. Marshal. U.S. Marshal. And so... So, Mr. Steve Repetz. So, I say to the okay, let's do this. So, I get the guy back up in my office, and I said, now, Steve, I need, just so I have this right, I don't want to make any mistakes, because I know this is really important to you, and it's important to me. So, let's make sure we got this right. So, you will not give us any rejections. Everything will be passed as long as I give you $424,000. Is that correct? Yes, exactly. You won't have another problem with me. Everything's going to be perfect. I said, okay, well, let me work on this. I'll give you a call back tomorrow. I go back down to the police with the DA office, and they play the tape. They said, we got enough. And so the deal was is he had to actually take the money. And so I was with the chief. I said, he wants $424,000. The chief looks at me and says, I don't have $424,000. And I said, okay. I could get it, but that wasn't the worst part. I went, you know, I had to explain to the bank why I wanted $500,000 in cash. But the police officers had to record every serial number on every bill. So, those poor officers. So anyway, I called Repetz. I said, hey, look, we're all set. The only problem is I can only get half the money today. And I'll have the other half next week. Oh, no problem. Yeah, that sounds good. So the chief and the SWAT team, we set this up where I would park the Hummer at the River Queen Motel, which was mine at the time, and that we would have him come down, make the exchange, and then they would grab him. Well, the funny part, I mentioned Nick, who was the manager of the River Queen. His uncle, Emilio, nicest guy in the world, he was our landscape guy. Well, earlier in that day, the SWAT teams were up in the trees with sniper rifles, okay? And Emilio's over there, get out of my tree! Get out of my tree! So he sees my Hummer and heads that direction to say, Dave, Dave! And so Nick grabs him, Ken Sharp grabs him, and they get him out of the way. And sure enough, I parked the car. The SWAT team is parked one space over in a plumbing van, okay, with plumbing, Ace Plumbing or whatever. And but the snipers told me one thing. They said, Dave, now if he gets in the car and he has a gun on you, we want you to put a white piece of paper on the dashboard and quickly go to your left. And because that would mean they're taken. And so thank God he didn't have a gun in the car. He had guns in his car. So anyway, he his smile on his face. He grabbed that money and took about two steps out. That plumbing van opened up and just they pounced on him. It went to court. He's found guilty. I did a little speech with the judge, and he was sentenced to 10 years part time, no parole. And so he went down for that. And interesting, about 2 weeks, I don't know, two months, maybe 3 months, I get a phone call in the office. Cindy goes, "Dave, there's a sheriff from Oklahoma on the phone for you." Not that I know of. And so the sheriff gets on, he says, "This Dave Lowe's? Yeah. I want to thank you. We've been trying to catch this SOB for the last 3 years. He has 6 counts of child molestation." So they were waiting for him. When he got out, they took him to Oklahoma. What I don't understand is how an Arizona American, the precursor to EPCOR, could have allowed to hire a guy who they'd never seen off a resume on an internet and puts him in front of Pat's face. It was crazy. So anyway, a little side story. We have big toys around, and the boys are want to play. And so we did. This is the beginning. You can see there's a lot of irons moving there now. Don Laughlin was very helpful. There's a lot of times that Morgan and the other engineers or whatever could not. They wanted to see it from above. Don would have us come over. We'd hop in the helicopter. He'd take us on around. And then, Morgan, how many of the ATVs did we buy?
Four. And I think one of them ran at the end.
Okay. Well, so we had ATVs. But Don, I'm going to give you a little note. If you drive on Highway 95 and you look across the river south of Harris, you're going to see a white line of painted white rocks. And Don had those all over here on the section line corners so that when he was in his helicopter, he could see where the property was. And so if you look across to Harris tonight or tomorrow and look about 300, 400 feet south, you'll still see that line of painted rocks that Don's folk put there decades ago. But that's how we did. But Don was very, very helpful to help there. Just more pictures of how much dirt. Don, I was going to ask you, Don Anderson, is there any way to give a round ballpark figure of how many millions of yards of dirt that we moved? And that didn't count the residential.
And that means, well, the golf course and the residential, and then we went into section 4 and part of that, and then we went down to section 7 and another 3 miles.
Yeah. So several million cubic yards of dirt was moved. These are just photos before and the basic grading. When we got it graded enough, I said, I have got to be the first guy that hits a golf ball on this thing. So there it is, okay? And Morgan in the Suburban, that was my Suburban. Morgan needed a four-wheel drive, so I gave mine to him, and I went and bought a Hummer, okay? A white one, you've probably seen it before. And it now has 328,950 miles on it. Here's the lakes being lined. This story is, I got a call about 2 o'clock in the morning. We had a little construction village down in the Wash and with the different companies. And overnight they had a rainstorm and the water was literally not going through the culvert underneath the Bullhead Parkway. It was going over. So that was one. We had to repair some things after that. Here's some more pictures. Here's the bridges being framed. By the way, on the bridges, just so you know where the influence came from, is there's a movie called Bridges of Madison County. And I watched the movie, and I said, bridges, okay? So I went back, I rented the movie, and I played it to the end of the credits because it was York Bridge in Connecticut. So I called John. I said, John, can you build a bridge that can handle 123 degrees in the summer? We can do it. So that's what he did. This is this massive pump system that was put in, to move the water from the lakes and falls and all the different. that was built into a vault, and it's had problems when it was under some other people's control, so we're trying to get all of that back up. That's the final, the bridge final. The landscape was there. There's the waterfalls. I took a lot of pages from the Disney playbook, and one of them is, how do you make a piece of property more valuable for the least amount of money? And it's landscaping, landscaping, landscaping. Go to Disneyland, go to Disney World, landscaping. So I wanted to have things that caught people's eye and say, what is this? I gotta go and see this thing. So there's Morgan in the Suburban and golf cart bridges. There's the big trees are now the little trees in these pictures. That's the paths. Once in a while, we'd have fun. And so on the left is Dr. Evil, known as Morgan, a fembot, who is his wife, Sandra, and that handsome guy on the right is Austin Powers. I gotta get out of that one. This is the first sign that we put out for advertising. We kept it very quiet. I took the playbook from Disney. Bill Lund was responsible for land acquisition for Disney World, and they created 150 different companies to buy pieces of ground so no one could put together that it was a big group or even Disney. They had to keep it. It was like Orange Citrus Company. You know that? And Bill was in charge of that. This is the construction of our sign out on the parkway. Because we didn't have anything to build on up here, it was all under construction, down by that sign, there used to be two sales offices. And if you drive over there and real slow, not real slow, but just kind of pay attention, right next to the sign is those foundations that you see that we built these homes on. We actually transferred these buildings up to the top of just as you come into Laughlin Ranch Boulevard, there's a, you can see it, there's a flagpole up on top. And we had our sales center up there. Here we go, the buildings are getting done, the sign's almost done. Now, this is the finished product. On the one at night, if you look real close, there's a person sitting on the sign after it was completed. And it looks like Morgan to me.
Great design people, and I sketched something up on the plane, and you let this thing happen.
You wanted to do it, and I said yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
You made it happen. It's good. Yeah. Oh, your name's on that song right now.
Is that right?
I noticed.
Oh yeah, it is. Well, Don Laughlin owns that sign now. Okay, here's the finished sales office. This is the clubhouse. Under construction. Where you're sitting right now, this is the foundations being set up. This is, you can see those tunnels, that's where the carts go underneath the building when they're finishing 18th hole. We also did the outpost, we call it the outpost, I think now it's called the junction, but that served as our pro shop, restaurant, and restrooms until we got the clubhouse open. Just more construction, that's the golf maintenance areas down below. Fire pits being built, that's the building completed. This is the first of the homes being foundations. Now, keep in mind, they're doing this without sewer water and all that connected. They're getting the houses ready to go, and the utilities will catch up to it. There's an aerial view. I see those four houses I told you about, good Nationwide Homes. Sandy, does that look familiar to you? That was from home away from home for years. This is another look from another aerial position. Those are the four houses that Sandy had. Now the golf course, somebody said we were going to do it in a year. We said that and we did it. But the things that the people were betting against me didn't know is I had 125 acres of grass growing in Casa Grande. And so when we were ready, Landscapes had the ground ready, then we had a semi-truck coming about every hour and 15 minutes
they pull up the backhoe, whatever, they load off the pallets of the saw. We had a crew of people, you can see some of them there, and all they did 24 hours a day was roll saw. And we had Flameric lights up at night. This did not stop. Once they started grass, it didn't quit till it was all in. There it is, rolled out. And if you look at the distance there, that's the Mojave generator station. And here's the course getting more and more done. It's starting to take hold. This is Secret Pass. And Secret Pass is a real place. And it's stunning. And I wanted to come up with an idea that I could promote Laughlin Ranch in a different way. So I thought, we'll make a movie about the Secret Pass, the legend of Secret Pass. So there's Morgan, we have waterfalls up there, I don't know if you know that or not. Hey Morgan, who is the third guy in that picture?
That's John Bernhard of Spawback Partners.
Okay. There's Dave. We found him 2 days later. Okay, so here's the movie, Legend of Secret Pass. We had about 80 animators. We had producers, directors, all that kind of stuff came out here. They hiked through the Secret Pass. They went over to Christmas Tree Pass. They made photos, sketches of the area. That is the mountain back here that I have the road aligned to. I call it, I didn't know the name, so I called it Witch's Hat Mountain. So that is the mountain up on the hill. And these are the people in it: Frankie Muniz, Ron Perlman, Joe Pantoliano, David Cross, Cheryl Hines, Graham Greene, and David Durberry. I picked Grant. I told the producers, you can do anything you want, but I picked Grandpa. That's a part in the movie. And he says, who do you want? I said, I want Graham Greene. Because I loved him in Dances with Wolves. And he is the funniest guy you ever want to meet. I spent 3 days in there. I lost 10 pounds laughing. Cheryl Hines was really sweet. My girlfriend Janet had a Maltese white doggy, and she brought it with us to the studio watching the things being made. And Cheryl Hines stopped the recording, came out, took the dog out of me because Janet was outside, went back into the studio, and held the dog through the rest of the session. So, sweet lady. Joe Pantoliano, Frankie Muniz, Shelley Berman on the left, he's an old time 1920s, 30s, 40s movie guy, super famous. Ron Perlman was doing Hellboy at that time. And this is the producer, Stars representative. That was my distributor of Stars. And we were at the Cannes Film Festival and it got previewed there. It got sold to Italy, France, and England. But if you think real estate was bad in 2008, the film business was even worse. Okay, so grand opening, ready to play. Alex Chaika in the orange, myself. Lee Stenchen was the third investor in, and Bill Hines on the left. And Alex Chaika, just so you know, he's a professional golfer, PGA, and you know, it costs a lot of money to put your name on their bags on TV. He did Laughlin Ranch for free. Yeah, he lived here in Black Mountain States. There's our rounds there. This is, of course, we're not nearly done, but the course is open. There again, you see all the undeveloped or unfinished areas, but the course we did open in a year. This was a rendering that I had made, and to kind of said, here's what this is. I want you to paint something so I can show people what this looks like. With the city council, to get their approvals, I loaded them all on that plane you saw, and I flew them down to Scottsdale. Jack was on that trip. And I took them up McDowell Mountain Ranch to a couple other really high-end subdivisions. We had a lunch catered to them, put them back on the plane, and I think they felt much more comfortable with what we were doing. So this was drawn to show people what we were planning. And that's what it ended up looking like. Laughlin Ranch. Okay, Ken is kidding. I'm a little late. If everybody wants to refresh your drinks, please take your cameras with you out onto the grassland. and about 5 minutes.
Way to go, Dave.
Thank you.